Hi, I'm Jasmine, and welcome to my new podcast, Creative Health with Jazzy D. That's me. Jazzy D is my nickname. So why am I doing a podcast? Well, honestly, as a kid, I grew up loving music, loving storytelling, and I would love making mixtapes for people for Christmas. I really wanted to be a DJ, and I really wanted to be on the radio. Well, I never got a radio position or a DJ position. I've done internships, but nothing have really kind of panned out with that. And so I feel like now everybody's doing podcasts. There's so many different platforms and ways to still be able to pursue your goals. And so that's why I thought, oh, podcasts would be fun to do. It's still a way to kind of pursue somewhat of what I enjoyed and wanted to do. And just a different format. Why creative health? Well, again, that goes back to my childhood. I grew up loving the arts, loving music, loving storytelling, seeing how important and how powerful music and just like storytelling and cinema could be. I would hear my aunts and different people talking about Young and the Restless and different characters on different shows like they were real people. I mean, I cried when I heard that Victor had died because I felt like I know that man all of my life. He's a fake character. But that is how strong storytelling can be. It can unite people together with vast differences. It can get people to talking. It can create ideas and get people to think about things a little differently. And so I wanted to, you know, create with music and film and put it together. When I saw Waiting to Exhale and I just saw how the music fit so intricately into each script, each scene, each storyline, I knew I wanted to do that. My defining moment, I mean, because I'd always grew up in the church, singing in the choir, praise dancing, playing instruments, always passionate about that. But it was when I first heard Whitney Houston singing I Will Always Love You on The Bodyguard. Oh, my goodness, I stopped in my tracks. What is that? I knew then that I had to do music. I had to write songs. I had to write stories and scripts. Like whatever I was going to do, I knew I had to work in this industry. I had to. And I wasn't a good singer. I mean, I think I sound just like Whitney when I'm in the shower, but to other people, maybe not. But I wasn't even the greatest musician. I love like getting instruments. I love playing on them, but I'm not Kenny G here. Okay. So for me, I just thought, okay, I will do writing. I will write songs. I will write scripts. I'll be the executive in the business. You know, I want to make sure that everything, I wanted to be A&R rep because I knew I had a good ear. And I loved music and I wanted to create these stars. I wanted to bring these stars. I wanted to be the Clive Davis. I wanted to find my Whitney Houston and just make, you know, bring this wonderful voice and wonderful talent to for the world to hear. And so that was just something I was always passionate about. When I became a teenager, about 16, I figured I needed to know the whole plan. And I need to know who I was going to work for and all of that. So I prayed about it and I felt led that to work with CC Winant. So I began to research. I contacted record labels. I contacted different people in the industry, got books, went to conferences, all of this stuff to prepare myself in advance while I was still in high school so I could start preparing to be in this industry. You know, I would try to volunteer and connect with local people. And then when I got to Tennessee, you know, I met the incredible Michelle Gibson and she got me in the door at the Stellar Awards. My first year was in 2008. And so I was so just excited. I had all of these plans. And my first year, the first week of getting to Tennessee for school, I got sick. And at first they said, They thought they had staph infection, the MRSA. And so went through a few months of them, you know, giving the medication for that and that never really clearing. I had to, like, take tests in separate rooms. I couldn't be, like, in the rooms with people because I had been told that I had this infection. And so it was pretty tough. It was really tough going from, you know, being at home with your family, your friends you've known all your life, to now sharing a room with people, sharing bathroom with people, like, just sharing all of this space with all of these people when you are not used to that, and just totally a different environment. The churches were different, the people were different, the accents were different, everything was different. And I didn't think it was necessarily a bad thing, it was just different. By January, they let me know that they didn't think it was staph infection. They thought it could be lupus. And so I was going to have to go to Nashville to see a doctor there, rheumatologist. And so I came back from the break. My grandfather passed Christmas. And we came back from the winter break. We had Stellar Awards, which was incredible. That was my first time. And everybody was there. Now, the Stellar is because I grew up in the church loving gospel music. I love all genres, but gospel is my favorite. So the Stellar Awards are like the gospel Grammy. So I was literally in heaven here because everybody was there. And like I said, I wanted to work with CeCe Winans. So she that year was being honored. She was hosting and she was performing. So I got all this CeCe, all of this stuff right front and center. Every artist was there. Like, it was just incredible. I was just amazed. I talked for days and days and days about my Stellar Award experience after that first year. I'm sure anyone who heard it could tell you how annoyed they were with me. But I was so excited. So now you're telling me I have lupus. This cannot be, because I just went to the Stellar Awards. I am so close to my dreams. I already, CeCe said hi to me, okay? So you can't tell me that I am not about to make these dreams come true. Like, Marat Brown Clark wants to add me on MySpace and like all this stuff. All of my dreams are coming true. I had already met people who knew and had already worked with CeCe and Demetrius Alexander and different people that I wanted to work with. And so they were going to connect me. I joined some fun groups at school that I was excited about, just far as business and music and all of that. And young Christian women. I had a nice boyfriend who was a Christian and believed in my dreams. Everything was going to be great. And then you tell me I have lupus? How? I'm a teenager. I work out. I was an athlete. I played basketball. I ran track. I walked everywhere. I'm skinny. I was a skinny person. And like, how do I get sick? How is this possible? How could this happen? And at first, I really didn't even take it seriously because I didn't know a whole lot about lupus. All I knew is there was a young woman from my church growing up that had lupus. And they got really sick and had a lot of different things to happen. And I knew I didn't want to experience that. So I was pretty scared and I was in denial. But eventually I got to the point where I would go to my visits in Nashville. I'd be a little bit depressed, so I'd go... Now, don't do this if you're listening to this. I would leave my doctor's appointment sad, and then I'd go have a steak at J. Alexander's. Now, steak and inflammation probably wasn't the best option, but I'd have a steak and some chocolate cake. It made me feel better. And here you have me now. I'm a fat woman, so... You see, turning to food is not the best option always. But I didn't take it seriously. It wasn't until Valentine's Day that same year that I was walking. And literally in the middle, I mean, just walking down the street. And then I couldn't walk anymore. I literally couldn't walk. It took me about 45 minutes and I was able to kind of pull and crawl myself to the apartment. But that was probably the scariest day, that first onset, because even though, yes, I'd had these scars coming on my face and this pain and just all of this stuff happening that I didn't know why and how to fix, me not walking just out of nowhere, it really impacted me greatly. And so then I went into a pretty bad depression because I was in severe pain every morning. I couldn't sleep. And I figured, here I am. I came here to pursue my dreams and to serve God. My dreams weren't bad. I wasn't trying to like be a porn star here. I wanted to work in the gospel music industry and be a light and witness to people. So how could I get sick? What was wrong with me? Why didn't God love me enough to not allow me to get sick as a teenager in college? Who does that? You know? And so I was pretty depressed. I wouldn't do really anything. Even when I'd go out, I looked pretty bad. I mean, pretty terrible. It was pretty bad. It was a rough patch. I ate and I slept. A lot of that whole semester, I can't even remember going to many classes. I think here and there, but that entire semester was just very rough. At that point, I probably should have gone home, but it was just in my mind that, well, if I just keep trying. So then the summer came and I had decided, okay, I'm going to take my medicine. I'm going to start looking into holistic methods. I started working out. I went home for the break and spent some time with my mom, got my license, or came back home with a car, found a job. I was excited about the semester. I was like, okay, I'm going to attack the lupus, but I'm going to stay focused on school. I'm not going to give up on my goals or my dreams. It's not over. And then that week, then one day I woke up depressed, super down. I didn't know why. And Obama, so this was before he had been elected as president, so August of 08, and he was at Belmont University. And Belmont was my first choice. I was going to go to Belmont first, but I ended up going to MTSU for money. But alongside of my music business, film careers, I also had a passion for law. So I had always planned that, okay, I'm going to do music business, get my film degree, and then I'm going to go to law school. But my family had some uncles and different relatives who thought, no, you should just do law. You're really good at this. I had done some business law classes and econ classes, and even my professors were like, oh, you're really good at this, maybe you should do this, and you could always do the music stuff later, you know. And so that day I felt like, I just want to go home. I don't want to be here anymore. I'm going home. I'm calling my mom. I'm going home. I'll just do law, whatever. And I don't know why I felt that, because all week I've been feeling good. I had got a job. I was excited about the classes I was taking. Me and the boyfriend, I broke up because this was a bad relationship, and everything was going to be fine. I was on path. I was going to be good. And then later that day, I realized why I had woke up and felt so down. My mother had passed away. And that really threw me off. Because I had just talked to my mom. I talked to my mom every day. And I talked to her around midnight. And the very last thing she said to me was she was fine. She was okay. So how do we go from fine to dead? I didn't know how to really place that. Because here it was, this woman who was my mother, who now I'm becoming close with, who now I'm talking to every day. We're becoming best friends. We're planning trips. We have these plans. She had these goals. And yes, she dealt with health issues, but I didn't know it was going to kill her. And so then that's when anxiety and fear of death began to set in, because shortly after my mother passed, then we had a cousin unexpected, and there was just like people just were dying just so unexpectedly. And so then when people wouldn't answer my calls or different things like that, I thought they were just dead. Maybe they were in a car accident, something happened, they're not answering, I've called three times, something is wrong. And I was already having the depression, the lupus, and now here, extreme anxiety, panic, and fear. And it really just went downhill from there. Really, it went downhill from there. My relationships, schooling, all of that. And no matter how hard I tried to not let lupus and not let the death of my mother and not let anxiety and depression overwhelm me and take me under and kill me and destroy my life and destroy my dreams, I didn't know how to fight it. I didn't know that maybe I just needed to go to counseling and get checked out and have someone talk to. I even had joined a church and put so much of my time into this church because I thought, well, if I put my time into something good, then good will come. Maybe I won't be so depressed. Maybe I won't be so anxious if I keep going to church. And so I was at church every time the door opened, I was at church. If the doors of the church weren't open, I was helping the people at the church, whether I was taking their kids to their rehearsals or picking them up from school or volunteering somewhere, helping with the tea or whatever, differing events and things of that nature. To eventually, the same people at that church that I donated my time, my money, my resources to, instead of them saying, we need to get you into a counselor. Something is off. Something's not going right here. You've lost your mother. You've got lupus. All of these things at once for a teenager is a lot. And maybe we should get you to counseling. They didn't say that. Instead, they said that I had demons and I needed to be delivered. And that, I just want to say, side note, just sidebar here. Don't ever tell somebody and a kid who has lost their mother, who is dealing with a health challenge, that they have demons, especially if you don't have the authority or the experience with delivering demons, because you will leave somebody messed up and confused. And so eventually that went bad. And so I went back home. I said, I'll go home for a year. Got to figure out how to get better, get together. And then I'll go back to school, continue on my dreams. Everything's going to be okay. It's still going to happen. And here we are now, 10 years later. I moved to Ohio in 2010. And I still live in Ohio. And I started working for Delta, and I've still been dealing with health challenges. But it wasn't until probably since I've been here, been back home, probably really over the past 7 years, that I really decided to take my health into my own hands. And so I got into counseling. You know, I see a psychiatrist. I take the medicines that are prescribed, but I journal. I take note of how I'm feeling, what I'm feeling, what symptoms I'm having. I try to exercise and implement healthy eating and meditation and mindfulness and try to de-stress and not have so much stress in my life and not worry so much, because that it can turn into physical ailments. And so here I am on this journey. And so I'm still on the journey. I am currently right now in the middle of a terrible lupus flare-up during a time of the year I shouldn't be having a lupus flare-up. My skin is inflamed and I've been in the house. So I don't understand why my skin is breaking out and why all this stuff is happening and I've been drinking all of this water. But I'm not giving up. You know, there are some people with lupus and they're able to just stop eating meat and they feel totally better. There are some people with lupus who are always in the hospital and die. And there are some people who have ups and downs. I am that person with a lot of ups and downs, mostly down, but really kind of could be different day to day. So today I could feel okay, and tomorrow I could be on the floor. So that's really my story. I'm still on this journey, still looking to find the best methods and holistic and healthy ways to fight lupus, to fight mental health, to fight just to live. You know, it really has been difficult for me because I have dealt with the depression and the suicidal tendencies. And so I'm grateful that I'm still alive. I'm grateful that I still want to fight. And I'm determined. I'm determined to not let lupus kill me, or it's not going to take me out of here without a fight. If it does, somebody will know that I fought, that I didn't give up, and that I tried to encourage others during this journey. And when it comes to music and film, I may not work for Cece Winans one day. I may not even get to work with Ava DuVernay or win an Oscar. But I am still pursuing my goals in the best ways that I can. And so I'm still able to get to some of the award shows and different things of that nature. And so when I can do that, I enjoy it. I love it. Even if my body doesn't, my mind and my heart loves doing the shows. I had an incredible opportunity to volunteer for the Donnie McClurkin, his birthday concert. And that was so phenomenal. And so I've been so blessed to still be able to pursue these opportunities. I am working. I have a wonderful and an amazing, there's an amazing film group here. B3C in Cincinnati. If you're into film, if you're into television, join it because it's incredible. And so I've been able to participate and learn in filmmaking. And I just being around these incredible creatives has just been, it's just like, it's encouraging and inspiring to me. So I'm still writing. I'm still researching. I'm still studying. I'm still trying to network and connect with other writers and other people and learn. I'm taking classes, as many as I can afford, and finding free things. I use YouTube and Coursera and Lynda.com and everything that I can because I'm not ready to give up. Now, I'm not necessarily, I have now turned my focus onto the dream giver instead of the dream. My focus had been too much on, well, I want to work for this person. I want to do this. I want to do that. And now I'm more so, God, where do you want me? Lord, let my desires be your desires. Because what God has for me is greater than anything I could ever dream of, anything I could ever come up with. So maybe I thought that, you know, oh, I'm going to work for CC. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. This is going to be great. But God has something even greater. And I think that even with lupus, even with having the mental health issues, like, God can still use that for his glory and for great work. He can still use this very podcast to encourage someone to keep going, to encourage someone to not commit suicide. And so I don't know how he'll use me, but I am open and I'm willing and I'm ready to be used. So I'm not giving up. I am pursuing my passions with everything I have. I am pursuing health and healing with everything I have. And I won't quit until I reach that finish line, until I get to that day where I can say, you know what? I'm not in pain every single day. Every day is not a bad day. I have more good days than bad days. And I believe that day will come. So this podcast, like I said, is really to encourage you. If you're living with a chronic illness, maybe you've set your dreams aside. Maybe you feel like the time is past and it's too late. Maybe you feel like you've got kids, you have family, you have your spouse you have to take care of. You have to have a secure and steady career to pay the bills. I want you to be encouraged, to find the joy and to find that passion, restir it up in you, and that you can still pursue your goals. even if you have cancer, sickle cell anemia, if you have lupus, if you've got diabetes, whatever it is, even if it looks differently, there are people in wheelchairs, there are people who have, I mean, just so many different things, and they're still getting out and getting it. They're pursuing their goals. And so I want you to, whatever it is, something you want to do, it can be big or small, write it out and set a goal to accomplish it. I don't care if it's something you put on the back burner. I don't care if it's something you threw away. I don't care if everybody in your life told you you would never succeed at it. You would never be able to do it. You weren't good enough. You weren't worthy enough. Your resume didn't qualify you. I don't care what they said. I'm telling you right now to pick up that dream, pick up that passion, and go for it. Pursue your health with all you got. Drink the water. Get enough sleep. Go have some meditation. Do some yoga. Talk to a counselor. Do whatever you got to do to feel well in your body, feel strong in your body. Go out there and pursue your dreams today. Find the joy. That is the overall message in every podcast, every episode that I'll be sharing here. I want you to find the joy in every single day. So if that's first picking up and remembering that dream, that passion that you have, and writing it out, if that's making a plan on how you're going to accomplish those things, if it's taking a picture of a flower, if it's writing in a journal, if it's spending time with your family, if it's cooking, if it's taking a class, whatever it is, find the joy. Find what makes you happy. Find what makes you smile. Find what keeps you going. What keeps you alive? What's worth living for you? But that's what I want to leave you with today. What are you passionate about? What have you pushed to the side, felt that you weren't good enough, it's too late, you don't have the time, you don't have the money, just a childish hobby? What's that thing that comes to your mind? I want you to think on it this week. I want you to create a plan. Write out some steps on what you can do to pursue those goals. And even if it looks differently, I don't care. I want to do radio. I'm doing here a podcast. Different. But I'm still pursuing the goal. And so I want you to do the same. So that's my time for today. Thank you for listening. I want you guys to tune in because I have some great guests that are coming. I have some incredible giveaways that are coming. So I want you to subscribe. I want you to tune in and participate. You know, give me your feedback. You can send it. I really appreciate you for taking the time of listening. Stay tuned for next week. It's going to be incredible. I have some, like I said, phenomenal guests. And stay tuned on my, follow me on Facebook, follow me on Instagram, follow me on Twitter, because I'll be doing some giveaways and you don't want to miss those either. So until next time, stay safe, stay loved, and find the joy. Peace. This is Jazzy D, Creative Health with Jazzy D.